I'm the curator of the Maine Women Writers Collection at the University of New England. Today we're fortunate to have with us two Maine women writers who are bringing together a discussion on envisioning our future with the wisdom of the ages. We have some very distinguished panelists today, whom Sarah Pletts and Connie Baxter Marlow will introduce to you. And the panelists will present some ideas on living in our world and the relationship with our spirituality and how we may envision the future. And Connie and Sarah will introduce the panelists. We feel that this church is an appropriate place to conduct such a conversation because it sits on land where many have lived and learned before us. Right behind our campus is one of the oldest cemeteries in this area, where lie the remains of the ancestors of many Portland families. I just want to mention that Connie's book, Greatest Mountain, is at the rear and can be purchased, and Connie will be happy to sign it for you. And also to mention to you, to remind everybody here, that Maine Women Writers Collection is having a grand opening ceremony on June 3rd, Saturday, June 3rd, at the library behind us from 2 o'clock till 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And everybody is welcome to come to that. And also we're sponsoring a wonderful conference on women's private writing from June 15th to June 17th, also on this campus. So, Sarah.
Thanks for coming. I really appreciate all of you being here. These microphones kind of drive me wacko. But we are taping this for the university and for anyone who will see it in the future, of course. And they've asked us to speak loudly and to stand up and speak to each other this way. When Connie and I got together to think about doing this, we decided that her book, Greatest Mountain, I'm doing great, I can't remember the title of the book. could you fill me in here? Sorry, I was going to say it right. Greatest Mountain, Katahdin's Wilderness, had already stated in its collection of writings, had already stated what we were thinking about a lot. And so we decided to take the issues in the book and have a discussion on envisioning a future with wisdom of the ages. And then we invited some of you here to bring us your vision of how you see the world, because it's us who creates that world. So we have here, and I will go around for those of you who do not know yet, this is Connie Baxter Marlow. I am Sarah Pletts, dancer, filmmaker, and writer. Also, tonight my film, The Phoenix Rises, will be shown. This is Arnie Neptune, beloved Penobscot, and now Wabanaki, wisdom keeper, dear friend, and friend to all of our relations, if anybody ever was or is. James Neptune there, from the North Country, a beloved artist and wisdom keeper also. I understand that he not only made the necklace of the turtle that he is wearing, we are on Turtle Island, but he also designs furniture, paints, does many creative things. We'll hear from him later. We have Richard and Karen that are with us, and they are guests of Natalie, Angela, who publishes a beautiful newsletter, a really extraordinary piece of work in this time, thank you, called Ancient Mystics, is that correct? Yes. And a wise woman, a word speaker of new truths, which we will hear more about today. Next to her is Ann Zill. What a delight to see Anne. Hi, Anne. Welcome. Who, among many other things, we have her to be very grateful to for the museum that's right on the other side of the auditorium here. Welcome, Anne. And then we have two more guests that are here. Hello. And Dick Buer is over here. He has worked with us from the university on this, and you heard Callie earlier. We're still expecting Cynthia Simon, who works in the life sciences department, and Michael Kellett is coming up from Concord. Must have been a traffic jam. And Joan Dana is here from the Passamaquoddy. She is an elder from the Passamaquoddy. She's in town. She's still apparently finding her way to the auditorium. So if we can feel friendly with each other here, and we're going to have, in the beginning, we're going to have an introduction from invited guests, and then after that, especially because this is an intimate audience, let's stay and join in if you wish, and we'll share our feelings and ideas on what it is that we're talking about here today. So, Connie Baxter Marlow, to start. Thank you. Oh, there is going to be a... I'm keeping an eye on a time limit just because we're going to try and have everybody speak within the first hour and 20 minutes. So if you hear a nice, pleasant gong, that means time to wind down. If I stand up and start waving my fist, then it means, you know, you need to give the next person their time. Oh, we're going to go in the order that you feel is appropriate. So if someone before you has spoken and you feel that you can come right in on the end of what they're saying, that's how we're going to do it. Does that make sense? You know, I didn't do this prayer yet. Sorry, we let all this technical equipment and everything get the best of me. I did. We've invited Arnie to do a blessing before we begin our circle here.
I'm opening this with a smudge of sage from the Western countries. This is sage which purifies mind, body, and spirit, soul, and gives us good thoughts and good feelings. It takes all the negativity out of our being and is able to produce for everyone a purification. So I'll go around.
know, you put me in front of a microphone and I forget. We've invited a very distinguished panelist. This is a white pine from our great state of Maine.
Now that we've all been purified, I want to give this simple prayer of thanks. We start the day off usually with thanking the sun at sunrise. We thank the sun, we honor the sun, and we respect the sun. Because the sun is our life. It brings us all the good things on this earth. It nourishes the earth. We call the sun our Father, and we call the Earth our Mother, and we thank them, the Earth and the Sun, for the life we've been given here in this universe. So we thank the Mother Earth for being here. We thank the Mother Earth and the Sun for the life we've been given. All the good things that we have, give thanks to the Creator of all life. The Creator of all life has made the sun and the earth for our lives. We are here because of this, these three. And we give thanks. I pray now to the Creator and to Mother Earth and the Sun that this assembly will have good talk and good thoughts, and that we will be able to speak from our hearts, not from our heads, our minds. Say, Wuli Wani Kachini, as creator of all life. Taho.
Thank you, Arnie. Thank you, Sun and Earth and Creator, for bringing us all together. Ladies and gentlemen, hobos and tramps, cross-eyed mosquitoes, and bow-legged ants, I come before you to stand behind you to tell you a story I know nothing about. Now, that was my favorite speech all my life, and it's such a gas to be here and say that to you in the context of this discussion, because it's a paradox, that little speech. And what we're talking about today is also a paradox, because we're presenting ideas that are conflicting to the prevailing belief systems that we've all been operating in. So I wanted to bring that to the fore, that as we start listening with our hearts and going beyond the conditioning of our minds, we'll feel that paradox within us, that conflict within us. And I'm just asking, and that's why we've brought these native people here, because, and the ideas that are in my book that Katahdin is bringing forth are ideas that are new to the mind, not to the heart, but to the mind. So, this is a time of great change on the planet, and it's a time when the heart is opening, and the truth, the true nature of things, the knowledge of it is coming to the planet, to all people. And it's my belief that the native peoples have been holding the connection to the unseen forces and to the divine energies and to the truth, and that in their ways and in their spiritual beliefs are the clues to how to walk in balance with universal law. And the other panelists that we've invited here today are people who resonate to that balance, and they're going to share that with you today. So we're really just heralding a great event that's happening on the planet, which is this coming of truth on the planet, in my opinion. And Katahdin itself, from my experience of being with Katahdin, and also from knowledge of the native ways of thinking about Katahdin, the Katahdin is an energy that carries this truth energy into our lives. And everyone who's had contact with this mountain in one way or another feels this energy and is touched by it and changed by it. And I've had two experiences with Katahdin lately that speaks of this opening and this this change that's coming on the planet. And that is, this past winter, just a few months ago, I was at a sweat lodge in Aspen with a Native American elder, and the fire that was heating the rocks, there was a fire in the middle heating the rocks, and I was about three tiers back, and one of the rocks exploded, and through a rock, a piece of rock hit me on the heart and fell to the ground. Fortunately, I had a heavy jacket on, and fell to the ground, and when I picked it up, it was in the shape of Mount Katahdin. And I have it here, and I'll pass it around. And it's also, I have a piece of rose quartz crystal here that I brought with me when I first returned to Maine, because I knew I was coming to speak my truth, and the rose quartz crystal is a heart chakra crystal. And after I was here for a couple of weeks, I looked at it, and I realized that it, too, was in the shape of Mount Katahdin. So it really pointed out to me that nothing is as it appears to be. That's been one of my adages all my life. And I realize as these energies are starting to speak to us and starting to come to play in our lives, that truly nothing is as it appears to be. And it's really our perspective that's created our explanation of what goes on in the world around us and what happens to us. So I would like to say that for today, if this panel does anything, if it can give us all maybe a different perspective on how to live our life and how to understand the things that happen to us in our lives, what our perspective has negated is the beauty of what's around us and the loving nature of what's around us. And we've invited this tree here to come and be a panelist on this panel because we, in this new perspective, we have an understanding that it is a conscious, loving universe, and that along with Katahdin and the other unseen forces, that this tree loves us and has all of creation is driven by unconditional love, and that this tree is here to give us oxygen, to give us shade, to give a home for the birds and the animals, because the nature of the universe is love, and we need oxygen, and we need shade, and we need the things that it gives us, homes and paper and all those things that it gives to us lovingly. At this point, from our perspective, all the human race can see is how horrible the human race has been to use the tree and to make all the things that we have made and use in our lives. But that's negating the beauty and the gifts of love of that tree. That tree wants us to have shelter because we need shelter. It wants us to have paper because we need paper to communicate right now while we are doing this written word piece of our evolution. So I just wanted to bring that idea into the panel, and that's why we have invited this tree here to share its knowing and its love with us. And for me, as I walked through my life and as I became a mother, and I made a commitment to the hearts and spirits of my children, I found myself at odds with the prevailing paradigm and the beliefs and the child-rearing practices and the educational systems. And I found that if I were going to honor the hearts and spirits of my children, that I had to walk out of the paradigm. And what I found when I walked out was beauty and magic, phenomenal things that trust, through the gateway of trust that I acquired from knowing Native elders, Native peoples, and listening very closely and watching how they live and what they know. I was able, when my son at age 7 took my hand and said, "Come on, Mom, walk with me into the unknown," when he dropped out of school at 7 years old. And from that moment on, we walked in trust of the loving energies on the planet. And we walked out of just about everybody's perception of how things are supposed to be. And it's been a fascinating journey. And we've discovered the magic and the beauty that lies in wait for each of us as we walk into trust and walk out of the expectations of a culture that's out of balance. And we start to cleanse our thinking and walk in alignment with our hearts, with our own knowing that says to us where to go, when to go, what to do. And it may not be at all what's expected of us. And I just want to throw that in today as an inspiration or a support for everyone to take what's in your heart and live according to the dictates of your heart and walk beyond the conditioning of your mind and know that that walking is what will take you into the magic and into the abundance and beauty that the universe is holding for us and desperately wants to give us, but which we have taken out of, we have negated our ability to access it by being in the frequency, basically, of fear and doubt. So that's what this panel is about today. And we are expecting, and we are, what we are doing here is heralding this transition for the human race and bringing the knowledge of the beauty of the universe through our Native elders to the white mind and to the heart of the human race. So I look forward to hearing from everyone. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Natalie Angela, and I publish a metaphysical newspaper called Ancient Mystics. And as I look out today, and when I was asked to do the panel, I just thought that it was phenomenal opportunity to further drive the whole process, the change and shift in consciousness that we all seem to be experiencing. And the basic thing with ancient mystics is that it validates ancient spiritual truths through scientific knowledge. It's been my experience over the last 20 years. I started, and I kid you not, I thought it would take me, 2 weeks. I'm going to find out all there is to know, and then I'm done. And what happened was I started with the Western religion. And from there, I moved into study of spirituality, not necessarily the dogma, but just the spiritual truth behind those things. And from the Eastern religions, I went into nature-based, and I studied paleoanthropology, quantum physics, all on my own. And what I've come to understand over the last 20 years is that although on the surface it seems like those things have nothing in common,
what could shamanism possibly have in common with quantum physics? And the truth be known is that it's a great deal in common, that what the indigenous cultures have known intuitively for centuries, for thousands of years, scientists are just now discovering these things. And they're really excited about the possibility, for instance, of parallel universes. Well, shamans, when they do soul travel, they know these other places to be real. And it's interesting to me to look at it from that particular aspect, you know, that you don't have to turn off your rational mind in order to experience the true nature of the universe, because truth be known, it's all relative and it's all important. And if you shut off your spiritual and your intuition in pursuit of the rational, then you're leaving off of a huge quantity and a huge part of what your total existence is. And the opposite is true. If you say, well, in order to experience the fundamental truth of the universe, I have to shut my mind off, then if you're also missing a great deal of it. It's in the union. Well, it's been my experience that it's in the union of the two where I have come to understand and experience things that I never knew existed. And it's just through that process for me. And with ancient mystics, it's just, it's an exploration of the totality of what existence is. And how that the deeper you delve into matter, the more mystical it becomes, because it's not all cause and effect. There's a lot of uncertainty, there's ambiguity, there's shades of gray, there's a lot of different things that go into what makes what we see to be real, real. And a lot of things have come, well, I don't want to go on too much, but that's just basically been my experience. And the tree, for instance, you know, we have the tree there, and to me that represents a great many things, because the tree seems to be a fundamental link to all cultures in the world throughout time. You can go from any culture, the Native American culture, the African culture, ancient Greece, Christianity, the whole nine yards. The tree plays a symbolic and a fundamental role within all of these cultures, and it basically has to do with what it represents. The roots go deep into the earth, and that's representative of we need to stay grounded. But the body of it comes up, so and that represents the need to experience the here and now and the reality of where you are. But the leaves and the branches stretch out to the heavens, and that represents the need to soar and to realize that you're more than just what you may perceive at this time. So it's the tying in of the three, that the tree is a physical representation of where we come from, who we are, and where we're going. And I think to have it there, it's really cool. So, but that's pretty much it. I hope I didn't go on too much. Sometimes I do, so.
That would be interesting.
No, because then it's going to get into a whole lot of other stuff. But, you know, but basically that's the whole thing. Any questions? Or do I get it out now? Okay.
I feel, a little heart turnover when I hear things, and so I'm going to just share a few of them. Tree. About 20 years ago, something like that, I decided that when I died, I wanted to be buried in the ground without a casket, and I wanted to have an acorn put in my navel, because in the next life, I wanted to do everything I could to come back as an oak tree. And unfortunately, everybody laughs at that, you know, and I couldn't get the lawyers to take it, the people who write wills, no one. My family ridiculed me. And so I know now that what I have to do is a little gorilla stuff if I am lucky enough to know when my time is close, if I really want this to happen. And I don't know that it would really produce, you know, that my, something of my spirit would go into the tree, but I believe that it would. And I have a great affinity for trees in general, but especially for oak trees. So here are a couple of other things that made me shiver. When I was a little girl here, I spent a lot of time alone in the woods, and I climbed all over these rock outcroppings of what I now know are granite rocks with quartz in them, and the pines and the birches and the oaks. And I wrote my own language, and I would disappear for hours every day. And I don't know whether you have this, but most of us, I think, have a few memories that are very strong from our childhoods. And mine is one very strong one. I was about 9. I see myself sitting underneath the table in our house, and I was stroking the leg of the dining room table and talking to it. Now, I say that, and I know it's another thing that produces laughter in people, and nobody takes it seriously. But at some point, you know, I think I had a connection to things that are considered animate and things that are considered not. And I didn't draw the same distinctions as a child. So life goes on. I go many places. And in fact, I left Maine at 17 and went to Barnard, New York City, to college, and became a New Yorker and loved the noise and so forth. And anyway, things go on. And about 4 years ago, I was in Texas with a group of women, and I was doing some work out there in Austin, in the hills of Austin, with some indigenous, so-called indigenous women. And we had a meeting of witches one night. And I'd never been to a convocation of witches before. And on the way, we stopped at stop at a New Age bookstore and get you can get a printout of your chart, tell them when your birthday is and where. So armed with this, which made no sense to me, I went to the convocation, and we sat in a circle on the floor, and everyone got their charts read by a group of women who were self-proclaimed witches. And when it came to mind, there were many nice things said, but the thing that was striking and unusual was that I was told I would have art in my life. Well, I didn't have art in my life before then. I mean, I like art. I was the art director of my high school newspaper, and I had a few things on the wall, but art was not in my life. And here, within 2 years, I was back here where I wanted to be, and I was running an art gallery on the campus of the University of New England. And now, just a few months ago, I was asked to put together an exhibition at the United Nations in New York in June, in connection with a big meeting of a lot of all the governments, to talk about where women have come since the big last meeting 5 years ago in Beijing. So this art show has to be made up of women's art from all over the world. And so I'm having a lot of fun understanding the breadth of art and the different ways it's done by all cultures and people, and in this case, women. And to go back to end with the tree, I'm actually very drawn to pictures of trees that people are sending in. But last week I had to be at a conference called an Earth Charter Conference, Spirituality and Sustainability. And they've just finished doing an Earth Charter, which is a written document. And it's really about honoring the Earth and all the ways in which we must come together to do that. And we decided to make the symbol of this Earth Charter a tree.
I guess I might as well go now. My name is James Neptune. I think to start off with, I want to let you know that I come from the Wabanaki Nation of people. I am half Penobscot and half Passamaquoddy, but I do live on the Penobscot Reservation, and I try to run a museum, and I got to that place through my uncle, who decided to leave for a journey up north, and gave me the keys, said go in there and take down some tour information and answer some phone calls. So I did, and the first 2.5 years or so, I was primarily unpaid. Well, I wasn't paid at all. So I had other things, my art, to kind of keep me going. I drew and designed t-shirts. My designs had significant meaning to them. People told me to get these designs patented. People from L.L. Bean came to a store I was selling them in and said that they would take them into their store if I could write the story behind each design. I never did. I couldn't patent them. I felt that whatever the story was, whatever was drawn on that design, wasn't mine. Because those designs, those drawings, came from the universe. I was just an instrument. I could not patent something that was not mine alone. Kind of nervous. But these designs, I guess I was supposed to come here to talk about Native American vision and stuff. These designs try to show me what I had to do, where I had to go, how to live my life. Because growing up, I knew I was Indian. I knew I was Penobscot, but what was a Penobscot? I didn't even know about Wabanaki when I was growing up. Moved away when I was 16 to Connecticut, and I was lost even more because I was away from the reservation. And I took refuge into books. And with all these books I studied, with all these books I read, I tried to learn who I was, where I came from, the roots of my people. And through these books, I found myself. But I was constantly taking care of people. Happened to me to really tell me who I was until I moved back home again. And that was about the time when Wounded Knee was going on. And we had a takeover up to Baxter State Park for about a week. We stood our ground and we wanted Baxter State Park back because that was our sacred land. Katahdin is our sacred mountain. Many people walk upon that mountain without feeling the significance of what it truly means. It's sort of a spiritual place where a person can go to find themselves. I found myself there on that takeover, and I found out who I truly was. I was a Penobscot. But I couldn't give up my mother's side either. She is Passamaquoddy, so I am also Passamaquoddy. I could never give up my mom, because my mom was my heart, she was my soul. She's the one who took care of me when I was sick. So my visions stemmed from going to Katahdin and realizing who I was. And being there at the museum helped me also, because I got to learn about who the Penobscots were, who the Wabanaki were, who the Passamaquoddy were. So now I get to tell people who my people were, who they are today, who I am today. And people come to me to try to seek who they are. So the circle goes on, the cycle of life goes on in all of us, no matter where we're from, no matter what people we are from. We were all, at one time, tribal people. And we all touched the earth, and the earth touched us. So these people are seeking. There's all kinds of people out there seeking today. I was told that I was going to, well, I was asked in a telephone conversation that if I could come down and speak. Sure, I can come down and speak, I guess. But I got a flyer stating I was already on the list. So I guess I was supposed to come down and speak. But I didn't know what to talk about. I didn't want to write notes down. I have to speak what comes from inside my heart, my soul, the spirit of my people. I have to let people know who I am, because they are my people. They are my ancestors. You are all my relations, no matter where you come from, because our Mother Earth connects us all. So I came down not knowing what to talk about, but a lot of things went through my head last night on my trip down. But yesterday afternoon, two people came into the museum. One is a person from Germany. She comes to the museum quite a bit. And she likes talking about things Indian. She wanted to come see how the Indians live, see who the Indians were. So I try to tell her, and I joke with her a lot. And yesterday was one of the first sort of spiritual talk that we had. We were talking about sacred numbers. She was wondering why seven was so sacred to many, many people. I said, well, to my understanding, to what I believe, I can't speak for everyone, but for what I believe, seven is like seven steps to finding out who you really are. And those seven steps can be anything. But to me, therefore, there's seven directions. Actually, there's eight, but I'll explain that later. When I explained to her the first four steps of the first four directions, starting with the east, going to the south, to the west, and to the north, those are the physical directions. And you have to understand who you are and where you come from each one of those directions, what they mean to you, and how people in your whole universe relate to you, because they'll be coming from one of these directions, and you have to understand them and know where they're coming from, so that you're able to relate to them, who you are, and where you're coming from. So those first four directions is mainly what you see all around you. And then I told her the fifth direction, the Father Sky. Sixth direction, Mother Earth. The seventh direction, where you look, is within inside yourself. Because each one of these other directions has special significance too. And you have to learn and study each one of those. And the seventh direction is when you look inside yourself to see who you are within those seven directions. And then the eighth direction, to me, to my understanding, how I feel, that eighth direction is in the universe. That's when you're done looking inside, realizing who you are, then present yourself to the world and who your people are. So she came to that understanding, and she realized a lot of that stuff too. She sees it because she studies many different disciplines also. And so when she left, I was about ready to close up, about 5, 10 minutes of five. Another girl came in. She wanted to know about shamanism, about spirituality, power animals, spirit guides, things like that. And then I related some stories to her also about different spirit guides that helped me. White buffalo. My clan symbol, the eel. The eagle for all people. And she wants to come back again. She wants to learn more. And I can only teach her what I know. And what I try to tell people is that it doesn't matter where you're from. We all have the same roots. We all come from the same tree of life. And we have that same energy within us. And it comes from our center. It comes from our heart. And if we're open enough, we can give it to everyone and share it.
Everybody. So I'm really going to ask you, invite you, if you will. This is the white pine from, it's up near where Connie grew up, right? Up from Pittsfield. It was, oh, I'm sorry, from Falmouth. Okay. And, I'm going to put the mic on the tree here. So we're going to take a few minutes here and listen to what the tree has to say to us today during this panel. And then who's ever ready to go after our beloved guest here, we'll go after the tree. So I invite you.
As I opened my heart to listen to her, I realized that all her relations are here with us. They're in our hands. We're sitting in wooden chairs. The wood is holding up the roof over us. Funny that her family is with us, silent, the voice of silence. And then later when we have comments, we can all talk about what we heard from our illustrious guest. I'm going to tell you something about the Tree Nations that she reminded me of when she came up here. I'm Sarah Pletts. Thank you, James. And I did a performance years ago called This Land, and it was a compilation of characters who have all, from history and from my imagination, have carried us into what's been termed, I guess, the environmental movement. And the one of the characters was John Muir, who's the father of the founder of the Sierra Club, right? Is that right? Yeah. And John Muir had a really interesting thing that he did. He was born in Scotland. He liked to climb very tall trees, oftentimes redwoods, in the middle of a very active thunderstorm. And he especially enjoyed being at the top of a tree and riding the storm. So I had a ladder on stage, and I played John up at the top of the tree riding out a storm. So as I learned to be more silent, to become a better listener in this world, I also, and love New York City. I was just there this weekend, one of the noisier places on our planet, our beloved planet. And I began to hear things from the Tree Nations. And the first thing I really noticed, although after reading John Muir's work, because he was very friendly with trees, I realized that, began to realize that everything has consciousness. I had a chance a couple years later, after I had performed the play here in the United States and also in Central America and in several places in Europe, and had taken the story of John Muir and the trees to different audiences, I was taken to Muir Woods in California, and I was with a girlfriend and her two children, and they had run on ahead, and we were coming up to these great redwoods that I had talked about in the play over a number of years, but I had never met them. And as I was walking towards this beautiful silent forest, I literally heard some applause. You know, the sound of hands clapping. And I kind of stopped and I said, now did I hear that? And as I entered into the redwood forest, I realized that the sound that was coming from these trees was made in the vibration of what I would recognize, which would be applause for my having told the story of these great trees. And I literally, I mean, it's one of those things where I couldn't have thought of it or invented it, you know? And I stood there and kind of bowed. And I heard thank you, and I said, oh, you're very welcome. You're most magnificent, and I'm very glad that you're here. Then, about a year or so later after that, I was in Santa Fe, actually in a little place below Santa Fe, Galisteo. It was springtime, and I was leaning up against a magnificent willow that was just starting to bloom in my friend's yard. I was reading a story about whales, and the book is called Sounding. It's a novel. It's beautiful. And the whales communicate to each other in the water, underneath, obviously, in the oceans. And these have been documented. I had the great privilege to also meet John Lilly when he was alive. And they have this amazing sound system where they send messages across the entire
entire planet. I mean, there's examples of how certain nets that have been put out that the dolphins learned how to avoid had when the nets were put out in a different part of the planet, whereas some dolphins had been trapped in the first nets. When they were put out in another place, the animals apparently already knew how not to get into the nets. So there's documentation of communication that happens through the water. And I was reading this beautiful book about the whales leaning up against this willow far, far from the redwoods. And I sort of was taking a break, and I felt that the willow was saying hello. And then I said, well, hello. And then the willow said my name, and I said, how do you know me? And they said, the redwoods told us. So I realized that there's a communication system that moves under the earth. Arnie's nodding his head. Thank you, Arnie. A communication system that moves in the earth through the roots of the living beings, much like the whales, and much like we do when we're dreaming, and much like we've invented a way to do through the news media. It's my understanding that anything that we do in the physical, already know how to do it in the energetic. That's how we know how to do this. I'm going to read you a poem. That's what I've decided to do today for my envisioning. And oddly enough, my poem, well, for some of you that know me, this may not seem so odd. My poem is about the past, in a way, because Callie Gurley, and we've discussed this before, I feel very strongly often that going to my ancestors, going to my past, and acknowledging deeply where I come from is what sends me forward in an envisioning way, which is what my friend Connie asked us to speak about today. This poem is probably more going to be directed toward those of us who come from the Western culture, rather than our guests here from the Wabanaki culture. So I have to find exactly where it is here. This one has to do with my upbringing as a Western person, but I think it's important to acknowledge this, because this, Connie, when you spoke in the beginning about coming up against an existing paradigm, this is the piece that has most served me in leaving an old paradigm and coming into a new one. I gotta find it though, so give me a second here. Actually, I just changed my mind. I'm going to do this other one that brings in a relationship with the animal kingdom, so to speak. I mean, I'm an animal too, but I'm going to do this one, seeing how it's spring. And I just left the Rockies, and the bears are coming out of their caves up in the high mountains and the ice there. This one's called When Bears.
And this old lady, an Indian woman, ancient grandmother, came, was motioning her hand to go to the this building, and it was an antique stuff, all artifacts. And then she told, motioned me to come on. So I went out, and she told me to pick up these, it's like a spruce tree. It's the spruce gum on the trees. So I started picking them. She was showing me the medicines. And then I was looking at that one tree, the spruce gum was laid. I couldn't reach it, so I just stood there. I kept looking at the tree, and all of a sudden, the tree just bent down to this part where I could pick it. trees burned, and it reminded me of that when I was about 18 years old, I had pneumonia, and I was in the woods too with my husband. And the only way I could have that medicine was from the pine tree of the blisters, that I would pick them and put sugar in there, and I would keep taking that, and they'd make me fall asleep. I was gonna last. It's to do, you know, with the medicines that from the forest. And it breaks my heart to see all the trees that are being cut down without them not realizing that it's medicine too. Another time was I was walking with all these people. There was no one color, but there was mixed, all mixed people. We was walking towards south, and all of a sudden, this woman appeared again in the sky. And then all these, she turned into a dust, all the stars up in the sky. And all the stars from every direction of the earth came to the center of the United States, even though Mac was almost up in the sky. And they were making a huge sound, the gathering somewhere. And there was no color there. And all the footprints, you could never identify whose footprints are those. And it's to do with all different sizes, different shoes, moccasins, whatever. There was only one people. There are so many that I have that I would share if I could. I wrote some of them down, and the other one was a huge light, a ball, like the size of the height that I am. It came from the east. And the ball was like a huge light. It came from the east, and it went all over the reservation. And as it go about, I had children inside the homes, and there was teenagers by the door. And there was teenagers on the yard, on the lawn. Those ones were being sucked in the ground. And the ones that were on the steps, they were trying to decide if they should come in or if they should leave. And the ones that were inside of me, they just knelt down and they started praying. Without even seeing the light, they could identify what that was. They immediately started praying. And as I was coming out of it, the words were that water from teenagers all over the world is going to die. Because of all the things that are going on. Another time I was facing the east. I was praying that I was going to leave my reservation. I was going to move to another reservation. I was having a hard time with food. And then I packed my clothes ready to leave. On Sunday, I packed on Saturday, I opened the door on Sunday. Saturday night, I was facing the east again in my dream. I walked out of my house, and this tree, the stem of a tree came out of the ground with one leaf, and it just kept going up, going up, and falling into a big, huge tree. I was standing there watching, and I could see all the clouds moving like they were alive. And they started forming this tree, and it made a huge tone for it. And again, I looked to the right, and there was another one, and another one. It was in a circle of seven totem poles, giant totem poles. And as I was going to walk down, this huge, like a glass of shield, came off from the row of ground. And the voice said, you cannot move. You cannot go anywhere. You have to stay. So I called my friend. I said, I can't leave. I have to stay. I have to stay for some reason. So before I was going to walk down after that voice spoke to me, I looked and there was this one totem pole that just went to pieces. And I could hear the children again. So I didn't leave. I was still in that home. And that's part of all the provisions and the rooms that I have. And there's a lot more. Thank you.
Trees were born, and I would take my gloves out, and I would put
thorns through everything, and I transformed into a wild animal. It was great. And I was a hunter. And I did this for years and years and years. Nobody taught me to do this. And I would go alone because I somehow hunted better alone. And I would hunt mostly insects. And as I hunted them, in order to hunt them well, I had to learn their patterns. And so I would follow them, and being young, I would do exactly as they would do. Those that hopped, I would hop. And those that crawled, I was on my hands and knees, and I would crawl, and I would go at their pace. So I was there for a very long time, following closely as them. I often hunted butterflies, and I would have to run around, dodge them out of the pace. And if I got close to one, I would consider the game over. I would consider that I won. And then with my recollection, I never once did any harm to any of these insects. I just hunted them with my being. Probably because I learned more to hunt. I'm so used to that nature. I think that's where my belief system came from. I think it was from those. And it's that time that I had being alone with the wilderness that I learned most. And I teach here at UNE, I teach at the Middlebury campus, and I teach the environmental courses. And one of the greatest things that I try to accentuate to my students is that they are so strongly encouraged by me to go out and be alone in nature, whether it be sitting at the sea, or going off into the woods, or just walking through a meadow, that this time is so important to who we are, because it's how we find out where we belong. I wanted to share that story. In getting older, I didn't know what to do with all this lesson, and I saw a lot of destruction in my eyes. To the things that I had grown up loving. And I went to activism for 5 years. And I did the whole shebang. I went to jail, I climbed buildings, you know, did anything I could. And one of the things I came to understand is that I think that people don't necessarily fear the message that the activists are trying to portray. I think they fear the people because they're so strong. My colleagues in those days were some of the strongest I've ever known in my life. We need a lot of strength to tackle 10 to 30 environmental issues every day and still somehow go to sleep at night and have a good dream. It's almost impossible. I don't think I made it myself. After 5 years, I left and I went to school with a group called the Audubon Exhibition Institute in Belfast, Maine, traveling to school and live outside for 2 years, traveling around America, learning environmentalism and community firsthand by going to the places and immersing yourself in your studies and living outside every night. And I went there, they asked me why do you want to join this program? I said, because I need to heal. And I think it worked, and it taught me how to calm down enough to teach. And my nephew last weekend, who's 7, looked up at me from the bed and said, I know you, you're a teacher. No one had ever called me a teacher before. I found out last week that I really am a teacher, which is a wonderful thing to hear. And I guess I teach now. I teach people that to go to a classroom and to learn about issues, and to hear on the news what's wrong, and to see on television what may be, to read into advertising, to get a job and just do the job, to write on a piece of paper and not follow the story back to its roots where that paper came from, is never a whole story. And that I ask my students, just follow the story back to the root. love to nature and where it all comes from, is where our birth is, and it's where our being comes from, and it's where we are. No matter what we're doing at any given moment. And I try to do that. And that's my vision.
Quay, say Quay in our language, which means hello. Quay is about people. Everybody here, we have to be creative of our life, continue to be involved in all the directions of our ancestors. Hopefully, we get to help me speak. So many things said, and so many things have been thought about our environment and about our earth. And so it's kind of hard to actually put things into the right context, into the right way to bring about a good message. I'm a Penobscot Indian. I don't have any other bloodline as far as I know. Mother and father was Nazca, both of them, and they both spoke the language, and they brought up in a time when some of the legends and culture were still actually intact with them. They didn't know, and I didn't know either when I was growing up, exactly what the issues were about the environment and about what we're experiencing now. Seems what we're experiencing at this moment is this time, that space and time, as we know it, the Earth is undergoing a lot of stress, through a lot of stress because of the, I didn't use the word greed, but it's the way the economic situations all over the world, that we have to take the resources from the earth, not honor the earth and not give back to the earth anything to replace what we've taken. All over the world, the earth is being taken out of the earth. In at least 7 years, maybe longer, the oil supply, they call fossil fuel, will be depleted eventually. They keep doing it. There's no way for the earth to replace it, except for fossil. But we don't have it. How will they have to do it? How will the sun and the earth be able to take care of this planet? This planet Earth now seems to be undergoing a change. We're undergoing the change of the fact that it's time to take back that which was owns. It has to find some way of replenishing that which is taken out of the earth, leaving the void. We've taken coal, we've taken minerals, we've created an imbalance in the earth. This imbalance, not only inside the earth, but on the earth's surface, is rubbish. Take all the trees. They don't have time to grow, to replenish you do that, and we say, well, it's progress. The economic situation of all the earth. And it's necessary for us to do that to keep ourselves living. But I believe that's probably another way to do it. It has to be. The creator of all life has given this gift to us. Gifts of Mother Earth. Mother Earth is a mother, as all mothers do, all of the earth. They nourish and take care of the children of the planet. The earth supplies us with everything we need. We overdo it and take too much. Humanity has always been known for doing that. Constantly take too much of everything. Restore it, and stay there. It is even sent out to those other parts of the globe where people need this nourishment to survive. The major countries of the earth, it seems they all do the same thing. They just pour it and keep these things, which if it could be sent to the other parts of the earth, if we start sharing, every part of the earth shares what they have with everyone. I'm sure that this earth would be able to be sustained, and the people as well. The sun itself, which is our life, like I said before in my opening prayer, the sun, which is our life, gives us our light, gives us our warmth, makes things grow. Everything grows out of the earth, out of the surface of the earth. We all have this always, the earth revolves in just the right timing around the earth to keep the entire earth warm. Grow all over the earth, things that we need to sustain the human life. There's a balance, a tremendous balance of the revolvement of the earth around the sun. It also does it to produce the water that we have. You see a cloudy day, say, we don't mind it, but the earth needs they need the rain, moisture, so that things will grow again. So that balance between the earth and the sun, our revolvement around it, in your face, without hesitation. If it did, if the earth did hesitate for maybe a minute, it would throw completely everything off balance, and we might all die. The earth revolves. The creator of all life has made sure that this will happen out of this entire universe. You see, we are the only planet, this one we know, which has this life. We are abusing our rights to live here. And the creator knows this. We always talk about God. In our Indian ways, we talk about the Creator. A Creator, a universal Creator. This is what keeps us going. This is what made our earth, our planet, made the sun for us, giving us our life. The other people are very unique. Places, though we are in action free, or mountain. And because we're human, we put obstacles for each of us in the way. We put boundaries and lines across the map. So you can't cross that line where you're prosecuted. These lines, seems to me, have to be erased somehow so that we can have our freedom of movement. I've traveled around quite a bit during the summer months in places, and I find I'm a prisoner of the road in my car. I cannot go to an ocean. I cannot go to a lake because there are people that long to do pieces. They say if you trespass, they will prosecute you and throw you into jail. So we're not free to go to those beautiful lakes that have created the nature. Even the rivers. Everybody owns land along the river. You cannot have access to the river. Even the ocean. The ocean. All these that are supposed to be free to us. So what is the answer? What is the answer to all? How do we make people realize that we all are on this globe together? We must share this globe together. We must share not only the access to nature, my Nazca people, the Wabanaki, had not had access to the sacred mountain because there's a ownership. There's a line around it. You can't go over that line. You have to go to this little gate to get there. And you could pay or you could have time to make a reservation to get in there. You can't just go there at any time. For our people, this is a sacred place of our Wabanaki. We need this access. We need to be able to go and find a place to pray. So this is what part of my visions and my dreams are. I have had visions like Joanna. I have also visions. I have had visions of the earth. I have had visions where I was above the earth, it's way up. I could see down on the earth. I could see the stars. And see the uniformity, the natural way that the universe revolves around the sun to keep us. Freedom that we're supposed to have as humans. But we as humans are the ones who make the laws and rules and regulations and so forth. And we cannot go against those which we actually make. So we keep ourselves imprisoned in a sense. So I think what has necessary. Whenever you make a statement, you should somehow have some kind of a solution. I don't have any solutions, but I do have thoughts. My thoughts are that the awareness, make the awareness, give the awareness to the people, the awareness that was given to me, to present it to the people who can do things about it. We can talk and talk and talk and never get anything done, but until the right people appears. Doers of the earth, the thinkers of the doers, and these thoughts, and visions, and dreams that we have to be presented to people of the earth who are the doers and can accomplish that which is dreamed. So I thank the Creator for some of the thoughts and visions that I have seen. This is a very small part of it. I'll end and so not a chance to talk. But this is what what I envision anyhow. And that's one of the keys that Connie is seeking. Tao, thank you very much. Good buddy. Continue. Tao.
Okay, so thank you all very much. I do want to thank the people who are here because of the support because of the university from the Cali Girl. Thank you. And also great thanks to Maddie Corson, Peter Riley at the Double Atlantic Foundation, and Lee Brower of Target Marketing, who have been incredibly generous and have believed in all of our visions, and I'm very grateful to those individuals. So let's have some food and drink, and then we will decide amongst us how we wish to carry on for another hour together. So let's take a break and reconvene in the form that we wish to.
Writer of the Maine Women Writers Collection. Tonight, we are very fortunate to have a performance of the work of Maine Women Writers, Sarah Pletts and Connie Baxter Marlow. The program consists of several parts. Laura Campbell will be singing and reading selections from Greatest Mountain. And Sarah will be dancing and showing her film of self-discovery, Phoenix Rises. We are also privileged to have Joan Dana, who has traveled from Northern plans to share her thoughts and dreams with us. We hope you all come visit us on this campus at the Maine Women Writers Collection. Contact me, Kelly Rose, if you have any questions.
Good evening. I am the earth, and you are the sky. My roots wind. And my arms reach above, growing in sunlight, drenched by the rain, dancing with joy and alive with the pain. So come to me, darling, for we really are.
I'm going to do a section for you of a work that I've been
have a way of measuring the fluorocarbons? Apparently, they drill deep down into the ice in Antarctica and find a piece of ice that they can determine, for example, is 1,423 years old. And then they melt it in a dish, under controlled circumstances, of course, and tell us the difference between the atmosphere then and the atmosphere now. But it seems to me you'll always do is walk outside on the street in downtown Portland during rush hour. Global warming? I drive a car. And each time I put my foot on the pedal, my leg does a little twitch, and I'm not sure why, but it's caused me to notice how it is that I do put my feet down, and what I put my foot down. There are places on this lovely planet where I have not yet placed my own foot. Are you thinking in this moment that it's upside down? This is Antarctica. But you see, if you're in school in South America, the map is likely to be drawn this way. Actually, I saw a map drawn this way in a school in England. So, for me then, it becomes a question of what happens every time Earth. Does the Earth have places that have feeling like our bodies? Does the Earth have emotion? Does the Earth have emotion? It has motion. If I am in a place where I've been before, I often like to think about what's happened to me there in that place. That is called, I believe, memory. But what is memory? If you'll play along with me for a minute, this is easy, you can do it right from your seat. I'm going to ask you to think about a place, it might be near here or any place on the road, where something happened. That something is a kick. Now, you could have kicked someone or someone could have kicked you, but just think for a minute about that. Think about where you were. Close your eyes. Last night, close your eyes. Think about where you were. You could have been in Paris under the Eiffel Tower, maybe. Or, you know, behind the teacher's desk in the second grade. Anything. Has everybody got the memory of the face? Good. Come in and see. Okay. So the memory of that face. And now, see if you can feel how you felt when that was happening. And now, just for a minute, think about what it would feel like if we were all doing that at the same time, all across the world. What the world would feel like. That's the excerpt from my piece about the earth. Next, Laura's going to do some reading.
Actually, I'd like to introduce Connie Baxter Marlow.
Hi, kids.
She's going to come up and say a few words about her book, Greatest Mountain. The new edition of the book
carries with it the understanding of the sacred nature of Katahdin and the broader worldview of the Native people. And so I'm excited to have been able to have this forum today. We had a lunch forum today where we had several Native American people sharing their ways and their knowledge and their dreams and their visions, along with other visionary people from the community. And tonight, with Laura reading the words of my Uncle Percy and giving them new life, we're just a quarter of a mile from his grave site here. My family's all buried back here. And so it's very exciting to have the University of New England sponsor this gathering and to bring these pieces together for you people. So with that, I'll open it up to Laura.
I'm very honored to read the words of Percy Baxter for you. And just in case you haven't had enough rain lately, I'd like you to just start by having you close your eyes and listen to the sound of the raindrop. With the protection of wildlife, the deer, the moose, and the birds will no longer fear man, and gradually they will come out of their forest retreats and show themselves. I want hunting with cameras to take the place of hunting with guns, aircraft to frighten wildlife and disturb the peace and solitude of the wilderness. Would that the day may come when all of Maine will become a sanctuary for the beasts and birds of the forest and field, and when cruelty to the humbler orders of life no longer stalks the land. The second piece I'd like to read was from an address to the Maine Sportsmen's Fish and Game Association by Percy Baxter in 1921. To most people, Mount Katahdin is but a name. To those who have both seen and climbed the mountain, it is a wonderful reality, and the memories of a trip to its summit remain vivid through the years. At present, the great mountain, weather-beaten by time and scarred by the avalanche, is almost inaccessible, the journey entailing expense, hardship, and discomfort. The grandeur of the mountain, its precipitous slopes, its massive cliffs, unusual formation, and wonderful coloring cannot be surpassed or even equaled by any mountain. Katahdin rises abruptly from the plain to the height of 5,273 feet and, without foothills to detract from its solitary dignity, stands alone. A grim gray tower overlooking the surrounding country for hundreds of miles. It is small wonder that the Aboriginal Indians believed it to be the home of the spirits of wind, storm. By day, man stands spellbound in that solitude, where man himself is an atom at the base of one of nature's noblest creations. By night, he is inspired by the majesty of the moon
as she rises and moves westward in a stately curve over the serrated peaks, which throw themselves up into the deep blue of the night, as though to join the company of the stars. For my last reading, I decided, I was given the opportunity to choose what I read, which was, I wrote one or two. But I would like to share what was written by a man named Dennis Kostick, am I pronouncing that correctly? In association with Wabanaki elders, from the video Wabanaki, the New Dawn. It is on Katahdin that the Wabanaki people see the sun